Actually, he's Dhanula, but we call him Dhanu because we work with him so closely. So Dhanu is a person who is very much passionate about, you know, safari guiding and leopards and so on. So that's why when he finished his degree in zoology, he found his passion and then started his career as a safari guide. So today, Dhanu is actually a part of Leopard Trails, as you may know, one of the Sri Lanka's leading luxury campsites in Wilpattu and Yala National Parks. And as you already know, in Sri Lanka or in the world, it's known that Sri Lanka, Yala and Wilpattu is the area or it's the national park with the highest leopard density. So I'm sure Dhanu is going to give you so much information about leopards and safaris and a lot of things that you haven't heard about. And it's going to be very interesting. So feel free to interact with him whenever questions are raised. You can always clear your doubts as we go on. You don't need to wait until the end of the presentation today. So feel free to, you know, clarify any doubts as we go along. So Dhanu, over to you, and you can take it on now onwards.
Okay, thank you, Sarah. Sarah, you can hear me, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. So everyone, thank you very much for coming and joining. It's a great pleasure to be here. And we are about to start. And as Sarah said, don't wait for any questions. The only rule I have for the session is you should ask me a lot of questions. That is the only rule. Okay, so Sarah is going to help me with that. If you have any question, please ask me, or you can use the chat box. Totally fine. Okay, so Sarah will repeat the questions if you put it in the chat box. Otherwise, I will hear you. Okay, not only that, I am going to ask you a lot of questions. This is going to be a very interactive session. Okay, so no one is allowed to sleep. Stay focused. So when I ask you the questions, don't hesitate, don't be shy, give me your honest answers in the chat box also. Okay, so there will be some fun games also. Please participate actively, so that will be so fun, right? Before we start, I would like to hear some of your experiences. Have you been to Sri Lanka, and what were the most amazing safari experiences? Like, have you seen leopards in the wild? Anyone has seen anyone? Leopards?
Yes, I've seen leopards in the wild.
In Sri Lanka?
Yes, in Sri Lanka. I work for Deepland, but I have been on a safari last year, and it was my first time after many years that I saw a leopard.
That's great. That's great. Okay. Okay, with all those memories, Andy says, he has seen one in Yala. Wow, that's great, that's great. Yala, that's special. That's a special place for the leopards. Right, without taking much time, now I'm going to start this the session. And allow me to share my screen with you, that you are going to see a lot of photos, videos, and a lot of stories in your screen soon. And allow me to go to this one. Right. Sarah, how is it? You can see this?
All good, Dhanu.
All good. Okay. So, first of all, allow me to introduce a little bit about myself. So, my name is Dhanula, and I graduated in 2015. Completed my degree in zoology, and I wanted to stay in the park observing animals. So being a safari guide is the best way to do that, because you're always there, and you don't have to pay for that also, right? So that's easy. Currently I'm working with Leopard Trails in both national parks in Yala and Wilpattu. So where I am, so to give you another idea, pinpointing where I am, that Sri Lanka, just below India. That's my home country. So talking to you from Sri Lanka. Right, of course, Sri Lanka is an island surrounded by the Indian Ocean. So the green color areas marked here are the national parks or the protected areas. And out of them, the two best national parks for the leopards would be the Wilpattu and Yala National Parks. Okay, I'm showing you these two because most of my stories, examples, photos, videos, they are coming from Wilpattu and Yala National Parks. Right, let me show you about our plan for the day. For the next 70-75 minutes, we will be following this agenda. First, allow me to fetch you on a safari for like 5 minutes. It's going to be like a mini safari, and we hope to see some big animals from Sri Lanka, including a leopard. And since the moment we find our big cat, the leopard, we are going to talk about them. There are so many interesting things about the leopards to talk, to discuss, and to learn about them. And finally, allow me to tell you some cool and interesting leopard stories from Sri Lanka and some of them from abroad also. Right, this is our plan. And as I promised you, let's start the safaris. Today we are going to the Wilpattu National Park, and everyone get into the jeep. No seat belts are required because we are going to go very slowly. And don't shout when we see the animals. That is also, I need to remind. Right, here we go. But before we enter, allow me to show you some of the photos of the animals. So elephants, we have lots of them, majestic animals. Then we have the cute sloth bear, the second smallest bear in the world. And then we have the buffaloes, we have wild pigs, or sometimes known as a wild boar, and a lot of monkeys, a lot of deer and leopards. Those are the animals that we hope to see during our mini safari. Okay, before we start again, I encourage you to ask me a lot of questions. Please ask me all the questions and communicate each other, interact each other, make a joke. I'm totally fine with these things. Let's try to make this fun and educational also. Right, here we go, and let's see what are the animals, who are the animals waiting for us. So we have a majestic elephant. Okay, that's a majestic elephant, came too close and wanted to say hi to everyone. Right, that was the first animal. Sarah wanted to ask you, did you hear the video?
No, Dhanu, there are monkeys.
Okay, let me come back. So then let's go back. Right.
I'm coming too close. Hey, how are you?
Right. Okay. After seeing the elephant, here we are to see the cute one, sloth bear, the second smallest bear in the world. You can see they have long claws to dig the ground looking for termites and ants. And they will go for some berries, and they are very fond of bee honey, and they are also scavengers, so they have a variety of food, so they are omnivores, and they will be up to your knee level. If you are standing, they will be up to your knee level, so they are smaller and they look cute, but could be very aggressive also, right? That's a different story if you are on food, but as we are in a safari jeep, we are totally fine, but not allowed to pet them. Then, after seeing, this is a kind of a rare animal to see in Sri Lanka also. But after seeing this rare one, we are going to see one of the most common mammals in the country, the spotted deer. Spotted deer are the favorite food of the leopards. And they know it. The deer know that. And as soon as they sense, as soon as they see a leopard around them, they are going to make alarm calls, like stress calls to communicate to each other and also to communicate with the other animals, especially with the monkeys. So during our safaris, if we can hear the alarm calls of the spotted deer, that's a good indicator to find a leopard. So these sharp alarm calls they're trying to communicate to each other. But the deer alarm call is not the most reliable. I mean, they are reliable, but there's someone else who make the most reliable alarm call for the leopards, and that would be... Right, the monkeys. Yes, they're more reliable, and the best thing is they are always looking at the leopard. So as this monkey is looking at the leopard should be at that side, the right side. So we are going to drive that way to find our big cat, our leopard. There it is. As we expected, it's there, and the leopard is looking at the monkeys. And the monkeys make the alarm call, and the leopard is not happy about that because he's exposed now. He's supposed to be an ambush predator, so he should make a surprise. But here, there's no surprise, so he's exposed and he's going away, and it's not going to win anything today. So let's try to follow the leopard, but seems like it's moving. Okay, Sarah, what do you see now? All right.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Now it's coming. So as we expected, the leopard has come to drink water now. But we need a better angle to see it closer and better. Yeah, here it is. Have a good look of this beautiful golden cat. It's going to have some quick water, and then it will go and rest for the day. So now this was this is late morning. So now it's getting warm. And normally leopards are supposed to be nocturnal hunters. They prefer to hunt during the nighttime. So now this one will go and find a shady and a cool place to rest until the late evenings. So let's let it go. And this is the high time to learn about them. So let's start to learn about them with a quiz. So I love quizzes, so I'm going to give you lots of them. So wait for them. So first one is this one. So I have three spotted big cats in our screen now. Now I want you to pick the number for the leopard. Who is the leopard out of these three? So they are very similar looking from different parts in the world. So you can tell me in the chat box. And Sarah, so what is the most common answer we are getting? Which number?
Two.
Is there any number one? Three? Okay. So I heard number two. So seems like, okay, let's reveal the answers. Then you will know.
One person has given the answer as three.
Okay, that's good. I love when I have the variety of answers, then there's always something to learn. Cool. So here I reveal the answers. So number one was cheetah. Number three was jaguar. Number two was the leopard. Right. Okay. I admit they are very similar looking animals, but quickly let's learn how to distinguish these animals. Before we learn about the leopards, let's learn how to distinguish a leopard. So first, cheetah. Cheetah is very easy to distinguish because they are small and skinny cats. They have higher legs, smaller head. But the easiest way to distinguish a cheetah is this black color tear mark, starting from the eye, going around the nose towards the mouth. So this black color tear mark, it's only for the cheetah. So it's very easy to distinguish them. Again, have a good look of the cheetah's body. There are so many black, random, solid spots almost all over the body. But when it comes to the leopards and jaguars, they have something different. Like you will see like few spots, they get together and make like an incomplete circle, like a flower, like a rose. So due to that, these formations are known as rosettes. So both leopards and jaguars have rosettes. So number two and three, those are the most confusing animal, right? So let's quickly learn how to distinguish a leopard from the jaguar. So there's a jaguar on top, leopard in the bottom. So you can see there are some obvious differences, like the main differences you can see between the leopards and jaguars in these two pictures, right? So I will tell you. So jaguar looks much bulkier, like a muscular one, like a chubbier boy. And the leopard is a skinnier boy, like compared to the jaguars, right? But and jaguars have a massive head compared to the leopard. So that's another difference. Now take a look at the rosettes. The jaguars rosettes are bigger, and inside the rosettes there are dots or spots in each rosette of the jaguar. Leopard's rosettes are smaller and they are empty. There are no dots or spots inside the rosettes of the leopards. So that's another big difference. There are more differences. Clearly here, you can see leopards have a very long tail compared to the jaguars. So let me ask you a question, quick one. Why leopards need a longer tail? What would be the function? Because everything in the animal world, there's something for a reason. So what would be the function of having a very long tail for the leopards? So Sarah, let me know if there's any answers. Why leopards need a longer tail and jaguar has a relatively a short tail?
Yes, we have an answer saying it's for balance and speed.
Right, balance and speed. Okay, good. But out of the answer, I will take only the half, the balance part. Okay, let me explain. Out of all the big cats, leopards are the most arboreal big cat. That means they spend a lot of time on trees. So when they're on top of the trees, they need to maintain their balance, right? So in that case, their long tail will come handy and will help them to maintain their balance. Yes, the speed-wise, yes, they will run fast, but only for a few seconds. They will maintain their stamina only for 3-4 seconds. After that, they lose their stamina. Unlike the cheetah. Cheetah is the one who run fast and chase the animals at least for 1 minute. And in that case, cheetah needs a very long tail to make quick turns and to maintain the speed like that. But leopards are not chasers. They are ambush predators. So their long tail, the main function would be to maintain their balance, right? Then what about jaguars? Jaguars also climb trees, but as they are very heavy, they won't be able to go to the top of the trees. They have to stay on lower branches. So they don't need a very long tail. Average size tail is enough for them. Right. Okay. Talking about climbing trees, leopards are amazing. So allow me to show you a small video clip about leopards being amazing and leopards doing some amazing works on top of the trees. Okay, that was from one tree to another. Right, yeah. So there was a baby monkey, and it's gone. It's in the history now. The leopard had that amazing balance, timing, speed, and everything was perfect. And only from the leopards you can expect such a behavior. Only from the leopards. The jaguars will not show something like that. So that's another difference. And the next main difference of between leopards and jaguars is their distribution, where we can find them. The jaguars are found from Central and South American countries. And leopards are found from African, Arabian, Middle East countries, and from most of the Asian countries, and from a small part of Russia. So clearly you can see they are well separated. Geographically, they are well separated. So that's another difference. So with everything that we learned so far, I'm going to give you a few quizzes. So yeah, let's have some fun. Okay, who is the leopard out of these two? Top one or the bottom one? Have a good look. Who is the leopard? Top one or the bottom one? Okay. Sarah, how about it?
We're getting the correct answer, Dhanu.
Everyone. Oh, yes. Superb. Yeah, the bottom one was the leopard, right? That's the answer. Right.
Correct.
Okay. Still, I'm going to give you more quizzes. So here, you just have to type number one or number two. That's it. Okay. So who is this? Is this a leopard? Then number one. If this is a jaguar, number two. Easy. I'm going to make it easy. Number one or number two?
So we're getting the answer as number two.
Well done. Well done, team. You are doing great. Okay, let's go for another. Is this a leopard or jaguar? Number one or number two? Sarah, all good?
Yes, all good. So we get the answers one.
Great, superb. Okay, let's give them another one to make sure. Who's this? Is this a leopard or jaguar? Have a look. The size, the length of the tail, the size of the rosettes. Then you will get the answer very quickly. I'm 100% sure you're going to get the correct answer.
Yes, all of them have given us the correct answer.
Oh, superb, superb. But before we go to the next topic, I would like to give you another one. So is this a leopard or a jaguar? Number one or number two? Who is this?
It's cheetah.
Okay, well done. Well done, team. Yeah.
I wouldn't have... so many. That's nice.
Superb, superb. Cool. Then let's quickly go to the next topic. But I'm so proud as a teacher. My students are doing really good. Isn't it, Sarah?
Yes, they did great.
They did great. Okay, quickly, let's go to talk about the closest relatives of the leopards, the cousins of the leopards. So taxonomy, it's a part of the science. We divide animals into different groups. Then it is easy for us to study about them. So all the cats in the world, big cats, small cats, even our pet cat, will be in one family called family Felidae, or simply cat family. Then inside the cat family, again, they are divided into smaller groups called genuses. And out of them, genus Panthera would be the most famous genus, because all our favorite big cats, tigers, lions, jaguars, leopards, and snow leopards, all of them are in the genus Panthera. So it is easy to understand the closest relatives of the leopards are the other members of this genus, the tigers, lions, jaguars, and snow leopards. So quickly, let's have a look of these animals. So lions, unmistakable. I mean, everyone knows lion. Tiger, the biggest cats in the world, the biggest, largest. And jaguars. And the leopard, of course. And here comes the most elusive and the most cute big cat, I would say. They're fluffier, they have a bushy tail, and they live in cool areas on top of the mountains in Central Asian countries. But I wanted to make a point here that snow leopards and leopards are not the same. They're completely two different cats, right? So it is important to get that idea to our mind. Sometimes that could be hard. So with that, okay, talking about the big cats, there's another word comes to our mind. We always talk about this word. We use this word when we talk about the big cats, and that is panther. Okay, panther. Okay, who's the panther? I didn't mention anything about the panthers in the taxonomy part. The reason is, in taxonomy or in science, there's no particular animal or a specific animal called panther. But there are panthers. We know that. We talk about them. There are panthers. So then who are they? So allow me to explain. So in African countries and Asian countries, sometimes people could use the word panther for the leopards. In South American countries, a panther would be the jaguar. How about North America? In North America, a panther is a puma or a mountain lion, right? Now you understand the panther is just like a name, nickname given to the biggest cat in your region. It could be the puma, it could be the jaguar, it could be the leopard, right? Then I know the next big question comes to your mind. That is, who is the black panther then? So again, among the animals, sometimes according to a genetic mutation, this is common for the cats also, sometimes they could get the black color hair or black color fur due to the melanins. So the process is known as melanism. So the adjective would be the melanistic. So a melanistic leopard, or simply a black leopard, would be a black panther in African countries and Asian countries. In South American countries, that would be for the black jaguar, right? So how about North America? So technically, there are no black panthers there because there are no records of black pumas yet from North American countries. But this is a choice of words, a choice that we make for the animals. So it is fine. I know there are some mascots and logos in North America, especially for sport teams, with the black panther, right? It's a choice. It's a choice we make. So it's totally fine. Right. Talking about the black. So let's go deeper about the leopards. So sometimes it could be the complete melanism. Sometimes it could be the fake melanism, like only a part of the body is black, then we call pseudo melanism. But when they are complete melanism, do they have spots or rosettes? That's a question. Actually, they do. This is a photo taken from an infrared camera. But from the naked eye, it could be very hard to see the spots or rosettes. But this is a photo taken from an infrared camera, so we can clearly see it. So you can understand they are not separate animals. They are the same leopard. Only difference is their fur color, or the hair is black. That's the only difference. Right, so this is kind of a rare situation that could happen in the nature, but rarely. Allow me to show you some examples that happen in the history which have been more rarer than the black color. So this is an example recorded from Scotland. There was a black leopard in a zoo, but with the time, as it was getting old, it started to develop some silver color patches all over the body. So this is a comparison of a normal black panther to that cobweb panther. So that was a rare situation. And there was a leopard recorded without any rosette, but it had some tiny, tiny spots. But still, it was a leopard. And one of my favorites, a king leopard, recorded from India. All the spots and rosettes were like merged together, connected each other. So it looked beautiful, majestic. And albino leopard, the last confirmed record of an albino leopard was in 1925. And still, we can see the taxidermic body of this leopard in England. If you are nearby Tring, you should try this. In the Natural History Museum in Tring, you can see this taxidermy body. Right, I wanted to show you those examples because these things are also possible. These things happen in the past and these things could happen in the future also. Right, now I have a simple but very tricky question to ask you. I need your honest answers for this question. What came to your mind as the first answer? That's what I want. Who is the king of the jungle? Who is the king of the jungle? Right, let's hear from you. So, Sarah, tell me.
Yeah, many of you give the answers. Lion, tiger.
Good.
Like most of them give that the same lion.
Yeah. Like most of the time, even I had the same feeling. The lion is the king of the jungle because I am a big fan of Lion King movie. So I thought Lion King, king of the jungle. That's what I thought. But I'm sorry. I have to break your hearts. Sorry, because lion is not the king of the jungle. So here you can see a lion, but where is the jungle? So lions don't live in jungles. Their preferred habitat is called savannas. Okay, so technically lions are the kings of the savannas. Okay, now we know that. Now who is the king of the jungle? The king of the jungle should be from the jungle, and someone should be someone majestic. And there's one animal who has all the qualifications, and that would be the tiger. The tiger is the true king of the jungle. Tiger King. Right. So we learned something very important today. Okay. Now, with that thing, here we come to the situation in Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, we don't have lions. We don't have tigers. But we have leopards. So they are the kings in the Sri Lankan jungle. Leopards are the kings in the Sri Lanka. Okay. They are the top predator, top carnivore. And they have a very relaxed life. without other big predators, and the competition is very less. So with that, they have become very large in body size. So physically, they are the biggest leopards in the world. So something to be proud. The biggest leopards are living in Sri Lanka. Okay, now I would like to tell you some of their social behaviors. So unlike the lions are the only true social cats in the world. Sometimes cheetahs also behave like that, like as a hunting group. But almost all other cats in the world are solitary animals, including leopards. But sometimes we see more than one leopard together in some exceptions, like the mother and the cubs. The mother and the cubs, stay together for like 2 years and then they separate. And the mother will be ready for another litter. So that's the time we see the breeding couples, males and females. But males and females will get together only for a very short period of time. It could be like 1 week or maximum 10 days. But the interesting thing is within 10 days, they manage to mate more than 300 times. Yes, you heard it right. 300 times within 10 days. Okay, yes, a lot of work, a lot of energy. Yes, but they have an excuse. They have a good reason for that. Let me tell you, I'm going to go deeper about these breeding couples because it's very, very interesting and very important. Okay, when it comes to the cats, okay, unlike the other mammals, the female cats, this is common for the big cats, even for our pet cat, this is common. Unlike the other mammals, female cats don't release eggs from their ovaries in a monthly cycle. Of course, they come to the heat, they come to the estrus in a monthly cycle, but don't release eggs. Okay, when they are in the breeding time, they will release eggs, but for that, they need a big stimulation from outside. And that stimulation would come from the males and in a very, very interesting and different way. So this is a photo of a domestic cat's penis. Okay. I couldn't find any photo of the leopards. So I thought to show you these photos and to explain. This is the leopard situation would be very similar. So you can see that there are barbs, there are spikes. Okay. Now, it is not hard to imagine what's happening during the mating. It's going to make a big pain to the female. And actually, that pain is the stimulation to release eggs from her ovaries. Right. Now it's understandable. But why they're doing it again and again so many times? The reason is they're not sure whether eggs are released or not. So to make sure eggs are released and the fertilization happens and everything happens according to that, they are mating again and again. Though it is so painful for the female, all her behaviors are controlled by the sex hormones. So she has to go back to the male again within another 20-25 minutes. So yeah, she can't help with that. So now I would like to show you a few videos about leopards' behavior like that. And I told you I'm a big fan of Lion King movie. Okay, that was a quick one, but let's go for another video. Yeah, definitely she was in a pain and she was angry. And as she's mad here, the male has to make a precaution because anytime she could turn back and she could attack the face of the male. To prevent that, he's biting her neck and holding her to the ground. So that is one theory. And according to another theory, this biting of neck will stimulate to release eggs. So that's another theory. But anyway, this is a common behavior for all the cats, especially among the big cats. You can see among the tigers, among the lions, this is a very common behavior. And as soon as he's done, he quickly jumps away and stay a few feet away from the very angry female. Right, right. Another, I would like to show you a few facts about the leopards reproduction-wise. So the gestation period is roughly about 3 months, like 90, 95 days. And usually in the jungle, in the wild, they will give birth to 2 or 3 cubs in 1 litter. In a zoo or in a captivity, a female can give a maximum up to 6 cubs. But that's a different story. That's in the captivity. But in the jungle, more than 3 cubs, that's too much for the mother to manage. So this is the most common number of cubs. And the cubs live about 2 years with the mother, and then they start to separate and will go on their own ways. Right, there's another interesting behavior about the leopards, that they are territorial animals. Okay, like one leopard has like an exclusive area, private area, and they don't want to share it with anyone else. And the males hold larger territories. Females have smaller territories, and one male's territory, there could be easily 3 or 4 females. And the ultimate goal of the male's life is to pass their genes to the next generation, right? Difficult. But due to that, they will not tolerate the other male's cubs in his territory. Okay, so if he finds someone else cubs in his territory, he will kill the cubs. And the cannibalism is also possible. They will kill and maybe they will eat the cub also. So the mother will lose the cub, and that's a big loss for her because she has she has invested a lot of time and energy on a cub. So look at the third female. She has a tricky situation now. She wants to have a cub, but she's in a tricky situation overlapping both M1 and M2 territory. Here, she has to be very smart. She comes to the heat, she comes to the breeding time, and she quickly go to the M1 and will mate with M1. And now she quickly jump to the M2's territory also and attracts him and mate with him too. So the strategy, I will use the word strategy. Her strategy is to confuse both M1 and M2. That's a good strategy, and it works. Most of the time it works. And in the due time, both M1 and M2, the two dominant males in the area, will believe the cub is his. So he's the father. So that at least they believe it. So this is a strategy followed by any of the females, because these margins of the territories are moving all the time. It depends on the current strength of the males. So the margins will move, and any of these females will have to follow that strategy. They instinctively know it and will follow it. So it is very, very interesting. This is common for the tigers. This is common for the jaguars also. There's an interesting thing. Even in the same litter, there could be cubs belong to two fathers. The same litter, siblings, but two fathers. That's happened because, you know, among our pet cats, this happened. There could be some kittens in different colors because that could be two fathers. And even among the leopards, this has happened, but they come in the same color. So we can't tell how that works for the leopards. But if we check the genetics, that could happen. Right. As I said, the boars are very strict about the territories. They are very aggressive about that. And if two boars meet each other, what could happen? Yes. As you think, it's going to make a clash. It's going to be a battle. Okay, let me show you a small video clip about two boars meeting each other. The one who is sitting in the front is actually a young boy who has separated from his mother recently and has come to a completely new area looking for a territory. And he's tired, so he sat down for a moment. And at the same moment, the big male, the dominant male, appeared behind him. He doesn't know it yet. So let's see how he's going to find it out. Yep, so they don't go along together, they're always into a fight, right? Another interesting thing about the leopard's behavior, let me show you another video. Right, so why they're doing that? Why they are taking or dragging their kills up to a tree? Why can't they enjoy it on the ground? So any good guesses why they're doing it? Because of the other leopards or because of the other predators in the area? Right? Sarah, anything in the chat box?
No.
Okay, let me tell you.
Answer, yes.
Okay, good. So they don't want to share it with anyone else. Of course, dragging the kill up to a tree, it's not about the other leopards, because all the leopards can climb trees, so there's no point about that. But this is about the other predators. There could be lions, there could be hyenas, wild dogs, and tigers, crocodiles. These are the competitors for the leopards. So they want to make sure no one steals their kill. And due to that, they drag it up to a tree. And they are very powerful, strong animals. They have the ability to drag their kills, which are 3 times of their own body weight. So you can understand that they are very powerful. Strong jaws, strong necks, shoulders are very powerful. And they're doing it very smartly. Because if you are losing your kill again and again, you are not a good hunter. That means you are not successful. But leopards are successful because of this key behavior that they show in the jungles. Right, with that, now I'm going to a completely new topic. This is very interesting. This is going to be about identifying and naming individual leopards. But before we go there, this would be a high time. If you have any questions, ask me about their behaviors, about their lifestyle, and yeah, anything. And meantime, I want to tell you one thing. So this is like one version of my experience, online experience. You must be thinking, is this good for the kids, right? Of course, I have another version that I go very smoothly and saturated without any serious topics. So yes, this would be a very good session for the kids also. When I have kids in the session, we'll go without serious topics. So this is something that we talk in the beginning, especially with Uday from Sensory Indulgence, who was a great help to make this possible. So we wanted to make 2 ways, one for the adults, one for the kids. So this would be a very successful one even for the kids. Right, with that, Sarah.
Yes, Dhanula, we have a question. So that is, are hyenas social cats? That's one question we have from Luna.
Yes, hyenas in Sri Lanka we don't have, but India there's one species, but mostly they're found in South African countries. Yes, they are social animals, but the leader would be a female. So it's a matriarch one. So the females are the superior ones. And being a male hyena is kind of an unfortunate situation, because they have they are considered as like second class citizens. Like, they're not treated well by the superior females. But yes, they are social animals. But they are not dogs, okay? They are in their own family. They're not in the dog family, they are not in the cat family, but in their own hyena family.
All right, and we have another question, Dhanu. It says, since leopards are the king in Sri Lankan jungle, do they still take the kill to the trees?
Oh, that's a good question. That's a good question and smart question. Okay, it is like this. In Sri Lanka, yes, they are the top predator. So they don't have to worry about the other animals. The competition is very low in Sri Lanka. Yes, there was a research done in Yala National Park and published in 2015. And according to that, only about 15% of the time, the leopards will drag a kill up to a tree in Yala National Park. So this could be a common thing for the whole Sri Lanka. So 15% of the time they do it. When they do that, especially when they make a kill around a big water body, where there are crocodiles. Because the crocodile is the main competitor for the leopard in Sri Lanka, the crocodiles. The crocodiles will come and try to steal it if there's a kill around the water. So when they kill something around the big water bodies, they will drag it up to a tree. So they have that power. And another thing, there could be some annoying scavengers coming to steal the kill, like the wild boar. And sometimes jackals will do that. And sometimes the other terrestrial small mammals. Then they will try to drag the kill up to a tree. They do it, but less amount of. They don't have to practice that, but sometimes they have to.
One last question, Dhanu. It says, how many cubs will a leopard have in a lifetime?
Okay, that's another good question. As I said, the cubs will live about 2 years with the mother, and the mother, female, will be ready physically and mentally when they are roughly about 4 years old. And the lifespan is roughly about 14, 15 years, average-wise. So when she has the first litter at 4 years old, in the perfect condition, if the cubs live up to 2 years, the mother will not be ready for another litter for the next 2 years. Okay, that means in between two litters, there will be at least 2 years. 2 years, 2.5 years roughly. But with that assumption, a female can have roughly about 4 liters, maybe 5, maximum 6 liters in her lifetime. Okay. But that's in the perfect conditions. If the cubs, all the cubs live up to the 2 years old. But sometimes they lose the cubs. The cubs will die early due to so many reasons. So in that case, within another 1 month or maybe 2 months, she will be back to the heat again and she will be ready to breed again. So it depends on the ability. It depends on the mother's ability of raising cubs up to the adulthood. So she needs to be smart in that case. So there's a famous leopard in South Africa. She's only about 11 years old still, but still she has given birth to 8 different litters already. So that means she's a famous leopard, like a star leopard in that national park, but she's not a good mother. That's the reason. She lose her cubs again and again, and then again, she comes to the breeding time and she give birth. So we can't tell an exact number of cubs that a female could have, but it totally depends on the female and the situations that she lose her cubs or not. I hope that's clear. Cool. Sarah, shall we continue then? Are there any questions?
No, we're good to move on.
Good to move. Okay, so this is going to be a fun session about identifying and naming leopards especially. First about males and females. If we can see the leopards all the time from this angle, yes, it would be a very easy thing to distinguish males and females, but it's not the case when we are doing safaris. It could be a leopard for the distance, a quick sighting, a leopard on a tree, so we need a better method to do this. So the size of the leopards is matter here. So they show the sexual dimorphism. The males and females are very obviously different. The males are bigger. They are muscular and bigger, and the females are smaller. And the male's head is more round and wide. Wide and round shaped heads. And the females have narrow V-shaped heads. If you have any pet cats, you can see the same difference. The males have more round. Females have small, narrow heads. And another thing, if you can see the neck area of the male, that's like an extra fold of skin coming. We call it a dewlap or simply a double chin. Only the adult males, only the mature males will have this double chin when it comes to the leopards. The idea of having the double chin is having a massive head. If you see the leopard from the front, With the double chin, you look massive, so that will help you to scare the young leopards away. So you don't have to waste your energy on a stupid battle with a young male. From the look, you can do that. And also you can attract the females. You look massive and you look dominant. So females will be attracted to you from the look also. So that's the idea of having a double chin. So let me give you some examples. So this is a photo of two siblings. About 1 year old, a brother and a sister. The one in the left who is sitting. That's the brother. He's bigger than the sister, and his head is also bigger than the sister, but still head is not in the round shape here because it's still, he's a young one. So here is a breeding couple, mature. So you can clearly see the male is huge. He's almost double in size. And his head is more round and bigger. The female has a small, narrow head. So that's the difference. Okay, quickly, let's go for a quiz. Okay, male or female? Have a good look of this one. And tell me, is this a male or female? So you have all the reasons here, all the evidences to tell me male or female. Right. Sarah?
We're getting the answer as male.
Correct. Very good. I told you this is a very good team. Okay. Okay, team. Here, again, one more. Have a look. Have a good look.
Okay, so here we are having mixed answers.
A young male.
Yeah. 50% says male, 50% says female, I would say.
Yeah, you must be thinking about the young males when you say about the male. So yeah, it could happen. There could be a confusion between young males and the females. I showed you in that picture. But before we declare a male and a female, normally we are 100% sure we don't see the balls under the tail. Okay, so we do that while we are doing safaris, but sometimes we do the mistakes also. But in this video, it was a beautiful female leopard from Wilpattu National Park, a famous leopard, a star leopard, which is known as Cleopatra. So it is known as Cleopatra for a reason, because she is such a superstar, such a model, always do us the catwalk. She walks towards us like a model. So we thought to name it as Cleopatra, a famous leopard. Right, now let's quickly come to the identifying individual leopards. Scientists have their own reasons to identify individual leopards, but I'm not going to talk about that. Safari guides. When it comes to the safari guides, we need to identify them for a very obvious reason. Storytelling. So when we are on safaris, one of the main thing is storytelling and engaging and entertaining our guests. To tell our stories, we need to know our characters in those stories. So these are our characters. So we need to identify them correctly to tell a correct story, a correct narration. We need to identify them. Sometimes we don't need any methods. There are some obvious features for some individuals to identify them, even for the distance, like a short tail, a damaged ear, maybe a different eye color, or maybe some scar marks. So these things help us to identify some particular individuals. That's true, but these things work only for these individuals. How about the others? How about the other leopards who have the perfect body shapes? So we need to have a better and a reliable method to identify every individual leopard. So in that case, the method we use is their unique spots and rosette patterns. Every individual leopard has a unique pattern all over the body. It's like the human fingerprint. The pattern could be anywhere, the forehead pattern, the body, the legs, even the tail pattern. It's unique to that individual. The mother and the cubs, completely different. Siblings, different. So it's a good method. And the best thing is they don't change it throughout their life. From the birth to the death, it will be the same pattern. Leopards never change their spots, right? We know that. So now we know how to identify them, but we need to name them, right? Sometimes scientists or researchers will give very unattractive, boring names like leopard number one, leopard number two, three, four, like that. It's not the best. These majestic animals, they have unique behaviors, unique personalities, unique stories. So they deserve better names. Okay, so allow me to show you some of the methods that safari guides follow to name leopards. Okay, I will need your help. Okay. So I want you to focus on the leopard's forehead, and using our imaginations, we are going to connect the spots in a way that you can see a letter in English alphabet. So in this case, a letter in English alphabet on the forehead. So let me know in the chat box, what is the most prominent letter you can see on the forehead? And let me tell you, this is very subjective. It could be any letter, and it depends on the person. It depends on our personal imaginations. So What are the letters?
So we've got W, M, D, B.
Great.
Those that we have.
Great. So, yeah, very good. Very good. Thank you very much for doing that. And out of all, I told you there could be so many answers, there could be so many letters, but out of all the possible answers, all the guides get together and came to a conclusion. What would be the most prominent letter? And everyone agreed on one letter, that was the W letter, right on the forehead, just above the nose. Then we were thinking about naming this leopard with a name starting with W. There were so many suggestions. One suggestion was a Willy Wonka. Okay, and the other one was the Walter White. You know the characters, okay? Already, you know the characters, famous characters. But there were some contradictions, so we couldn't come to a conclusion. We couldn't come to a final conclusion. We thought, okay, let's go very simply and name this leopard as Mr. W. Simple as that. Mr. W was a famous leopard. Just like the same way, there was another leopard. We name it according to another letter in English alphabet. What in this case, for this leopard, what is your answer?
So we are receiving answers saying U.
U. Yeah.
Then O.
Oh, okay. Great. Great. If you say the U, if you can make a simple like a smiley face out of it also. Yeah. But that's not what we thought. A smiley face, no, this is a dominant male. We thought to go for a different letter. Not the U letter. Of course, U is more prominent, but we wanted to go for a different one. And we thought about the letter J. So I present you Mr. J, which is one of the dominant males in Yala National Park. It's still one of the dominant males. Right, let's forget the letters. Let's go for numbers. What is the most prominent number you see here? Then we will name it according to that number.
So, Dhanu, we are receiving the answers saying number 8.
Okay. Then I present you Mr. 8. Here you go. Yes, you're right. Well done.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then, okay. Yeah, that was the easy one. Now I'm going to give you a tricky one, a hard one. So here, two numbers, two different numbers together, side by side. So what is the, what is your answer and what could be her name? Two different numbers together, side by side on the forehead.
So one says 87.
87, okay. Good one, good suggestion.
5 and 7, 77.
77, okay. Okay, you need to understand this is not about the highest number. This is not a bid.
Then one says 33.
33, keep going, keep going. Anything? Okay.
70, 53, 38.
38. Okay. I really appreciate your effort. Thank you very much. Really appreciate that. But there's one obvious answer here. Okay. You will be really upset when I show you
we
this.
We have 1 saying 25.
1 saying 25. Okay. I think we have a winner. 25. Here it is. Here it is. Mrs. 25. This is a female leopard from Wilpattu National Park. 25. That's the name we gave her. Mrs. 25. Okay. Then another name that we gave this leopard. When we saw him for the first time, we saw a very particular pattern that looked like a magic lamp. You know the story, right? Because we are big fans of this story. We couldn't get rid of this from our mind. We couldn't get rid of it. So we thought, okay, let's continue with the story. And okay, what do you suggest me to name this leopard? If you know the story about this magic lamp, what do you want me to name this leopard? But this is a boy. Okay.
So then we are getting answers saying Aladdin.
That's great. Yeah, that's what we thought. That's what we thought. And we named that leopard as Aladdin. Good. But until this moment, you understood that all the names were given according to the spot pattern on the forehead, the names, numbers. But sometimes we give names according to their behaviors, their personalities, the brave things they do. And this is a classic example, a famous leopard called Harakora. He earned his name according to his behavior. He always go for the buffaloes and somehow managed to steal a young buffalo. And the meaning of the name Harakora is buffalo thief, or simply the cattle thief. So he earned his name, and he lives for his name. So he's such a legend, a famous leopard from Yala National Park. And sometimes the leopards do some mistakes, especially the young leopards. Have a look of this video. Very curious young leopard. Okay, unfortunately, we couldn't see what happened next because that was late evening. We had to leave them, and then they started to move towards the interior into the jungle. We couldn't see what happened, and I was so I badly wanted to know what happened. And as the first thing in the next morning, I went to check that area, and I found the leopard on a rock, resting on a rock with this. So this was a very famous photo, and yes, you got right. The leopard got into trouble, and I'm sure this wasn't the only one. Maybe it had more and got rid of them by the morning. But when we took this photo, it had one quail right in the center. And okay, if you are thinking about a name for this leopard, what do you suggest me? Do we get anything, Sarah?
Yes, we have an insane unicorn.
Very good. Yeah, that's right. That's what we thought. Yeah, the same thing. Unicorn. And we used to call him Unicorn. He was a famous leopard for us, but unfortunately we haven't seen him recently. But anyway, the legend still lives. There's another way, that obvious things on the face. So like this. So she has one blind eye. She had this from the very beginning, but she's okay. She's a good hunter. She was a good mother also. But when we wanted to name this leopard, she had one eye. So two words, one eye, switch. Ivon together quickly. Ivon became Ivon, Mrs. Ivon, a name that we gave her. There was another leopard got into a fight with another female leopard, and she lost part of her nose. So a black nose, or black nose. That's her name. Obvious, right, guys? Until this moment, all the names were given in a very informal way, right? You understood that. So it depends on the person who named them. And there could be some leopards with different names for the same leopard, two or three names for the same leopard. So it could happen. This is very informal, right? Now I'm going to show you a very formal method of naming leopards. This is this method developed in South Africa. And we learn from South Africa because we are closely working with some of the lodges in South Africa. So this method is known as whisker spot pattern ID techniques. This is like very scientific and very formal method. So in this case, to name a leopard, we need a clear headshot. And you can see the whiskers of the leopard, and out of them, the highest whisker. From the highest whiskers, you can see a line of spots, a horizontal line of spots coming from both sides towards the nose. And that line would be our reference line or indicating line. Now I want you to look just above the indicating line. Over there, you can see some spots. Okay, three spots in each side, and we will count it and we'll write down. So three and three. Okay, three to three. We will count it and write down as a ratio. And to give a meaningful and a good name, so we write down the name of the territory or the born area or at least a landmark where it lives, right? Temple Road, 3-3. And finally, write down the gender, male or female. So this is a method that we use. So the three parts, the name of the territory, viscous spot ratio, and the gender. Okay, I know it was tricky because that was the first time. I'm going to give you another example, a closer picture. So here, before we count the viscous spots, okay, this is our indicating line. I want to tell you one more thing. Along the nose line, you see another spot, but we will not count it because every individual has that spot along the nose line. I'm telling you because sometimes you could get confused with that. But we will count the spots in between the indicating line and the nose line. We don't take the spot of the on the nose line. So here, two spots of the right side of the leopard, left side of the photo, but the right side of the leopard. And the three spots in the other side. So we will write down first the right side of the leopard. Two spots in the right side, three spots of the left side. And then the name of the territory, male or female. So this is what we do. Now, I know what you're thinking. How many spots could be there maximum in one side? According to our experience, 5 spots. That could be the maximum. There was one incident with 6 spots, but that's kind of an exception. So maximum 5 spots. So that gives us 25 possible combinations. There are thousands of leopards in the world, only 25 possible combinations. That means there could be leopards with the same number of spots, same ratio. Yes, that's true. Even in the same national park, in the same area, there could be several individuals with the same number of spots. But still, you can clearly see the configuration of the how the spots are located is different from one individual to another. So top line with the 3-3 ratio and the lower line, that would be 3 and 4. You can clearly see they are not the same pattern. The number is right, but the configuration is different. Right, I hope you got a quick idea about this method, but to make sure, I'm going to give you a few exercises. So I would like you to tell me the number or the ratio of spots of this particular individual. So what would be that? The number of spots of each side. Do we get the answers?
Yes, we get 1-1.
Right. That is the correct answer. That is the correct answer. So the territory, the rough ratio, and the male or female. So this is 1-1. Okay, we'll give you another one. How about this one? What would be the spot ratio?
Three, four is the answer we get.
Very good. Yeah. So isn't it? This is a brilliant team, the brilliant classroom, right? I'm so proud. Yeah. So this is the ratio. So quickly we'll go for another one. Okay, this could be a tricky one, so be careful before naming. This is Mrs. Ivon. So what would be her spot ratio? Remember, I told you to avoid something when you count the spots. With that thing in the mind,
we get the answer saying 2-2, and some says 2-1.
Okay. Actually, the correct answer is 2-2. So actually, of the left side of the leopard, there's a spot along the nose line, and just below it, there's another spot. So we have to count that one. So 2 spots in both sides. Right. So this is the method that we use, and you can clearly understand. So how easy this method? If you know the ratio, you can quickly narrow down. From your database, if you know the spot ratio, if you have the database, you can quickly narrow it down from the database. You can quickly identify that leopard. So as a few steps to do that, so check the viscous spot ratio and then narrow down your search from your database, and then check the spots and other forehead pattern or the other obvious things for that individual, and everything you can use everything and match. And then you will be there and you can confirm the identity. Right, so we have done thousands of safaris in Yala and Wilpattu National Park. We have a good database and we are proud. Very soon, we are about to publish our database. And let me show you a small video about our database. So this is a screen recorder from the backside. So this is what we do. Like, we have a good database for the leopards of Yala and Wilpattu. So if you search that spot ratio in that search bar, it quickly narrow down to some individuals. And out of them, then you can select your leopard. And when you go to that profile, you have something like this. So you can check what are the other unique marks that you can use to identify that particular individual. And then again, there will be an about section about that leopard, when it was born, how many litters, and so many other information. And then you can go to the family. So there's a family tree that we have recorded for more than 10 years. Sometimes we go for several generations. So it is very, very important to learn about them. So about the conservation of leopards, about the research about the leopards, these information are very, very important. So we have like more details for each individual. Family-wise, we have different lineages, family histories. So this information will be very important for us to narrate stories, to tell stories about the leopards and to understand their behaviors. If you know the identity and about the relationship of the leopards, then we can quickly do that. So again, if you type the 22, everything will be narrowed down. So it will be very easy for you. And one more thing, if you know where it was born and if you know the exact name, so you can just type the location. And then you will get an idea what kind of animals, what are kind of individuals lived there. So let's say Panwal, and out of them, there will be two individuals. And then we come to here and you will get a, like if it is a living animal, there will be a map for that individual, the territory. So when you go there, you will have a map of Yala National Park and highlighted area of that individual. Like according to the sightings, we have roughly marked his territory. So we can zoom it and we can see that also. And for every individual, we have given a media section with a lot of photos, and sometimes some videos have added into that media section. So we are very proud about this thing, and this could be the best database in Sri Lanka for the leopards. So we are going to publish it very soon. If you are interested of this website, Diethelam will send you all the information. So you can ask them and they will send you all the information. Right, now I'm going for stories. Going for the stories, but I'm not going to let you go easily. I'm going to give you a test. So we learned something very important. Every individual leopard has a unique spot pattern and they don't change it with the time. Now I want you to take a good look of these two photos and tell me, is this the same leopard or not? So just type same or not. So let's see. Don't get fooled by the size or the age. So just consider the pattern, especially the spot pattern on the forehead.
So then we're getting answers saying they're the same.
Exactly. Well done. Yeah. No wonder, no surprise there. I knew it coming that. Yeah. Yes, this is the same leopard. The first photo when it was like 3 months old, the second photo like when it was like 2 years old. It's the same leopard. It has grown up, but the pattern is the same. Okay, test number two. Is this the same leopard or not? I'm thinking like in the beginning, we were trying to distinguish leopards and jaguars. Now we are trying to distinguish two individual leopards. So we have come a long way. So is this the same or not?
Getting the answer saying they're different. So
different, yes. It is different. Yes, well done. So these are two different leopards from two different national parks. But I added these two as my test because the spot pattern on the forehead, it looks similar. But when you go for the details, you see they are different. So well done. So as a gift, I'm going to skip the test number three. And I will go for the stories. Okay, I have a few stories. Some stories are like very, very smooth stories, like the things that we expect to happen, like happy ending like that. But there could be some stories which are very weird. for us, but could be very interesting to learn about those things. Right, first story about a group of leopards. Normally, this is not happening in the jungle. This could be a very rare situation. But when we have a group of leopards, then we have a collective noun for it. It's called a leap of leopards, like the pride of lions. And for the tigers, it's called ambush of tigers. And then for the leopard, it's leap of leopards. Okay, the story of this leap is very interesting. There was a family of mother and three daughters, but that's not a leap. That's a family. Then outsider, a young male came and joined this family to complete the leap. But very interestingly, this young male was none other than the nephew of this mother leopard. That means this mother had a sister when she was young and they separated. And that sister had a son. That son was 2 years old, separated from his mother and was moving, thinking to find a new territory. And one day he met his auntie. And auntie identified the nephew. How did she identify? What we believe, from the mother's side, the females, they can identify the close relatives from a unique smell. By that, they can avoid the close relatives to breed. That means they will avoid them to avoid inbreeding. So that's very important for them. So that's how this mother leopard understood this is a close relative and did welcome to the family. I mean, only for a few days, everyone was happy. It was like a family reunion in the jungle, except the dominant male in the area. The dominant male didn't like this young male, so he had a fight and chased him away. But that's the nature. Until that moment, it was a family reunion, happy story from the jungle. Talking about the family reunions, there's another video I would like to show you. It's a sweet moment. So that was a sweet moment. The father and the son met each other for the first time. Why this is first time? Because the mother is very protective and she will hide the cub in different places until they are about 3 months, 4 months old. So this is such a moment. The father met his son. But the mother has done a great job to convince this big male to think that you are the father. So that's good. Otherwise, this sighting could have gone in a different way. But this is a sweet moment. But the most funny thing I find here is the face of the male, right? It's a very confused male. It's a typical father face because he's still processing inside his mind. He doesn't know what to do with this young boy. So that's what I find funny, but it's a sweet moment from the jungle. Okay, then another story from Yala. This boy was a very curious and naughty boy. And always he wanted to do something very adventurous. But mother said, you are still young. Don't do any stupid things. But he didn't listen. One day the mother was sleeping and the boy saw a wild boar for the distance. He thinks, okay, this is the day I prove myself I'm a big boy. But he doesn't have any experience of hunting. He's going towards the wild pig. One mistake. He didn't see the other members of the wild pigs behind the bushes. He thought only one. So he was going closer and closer. Actually, he was walking towards a disaster. And the first wild pig saw him coming and he got really angry and started to attack the boy. And the boy still thinks this is only one, so I can manage it. So he's jumping here and there and trying to manage the situation. This is for a few seconds. And there was a moment, there was a point that he had to make a decision because all other wild pigs were coming that way. So he made the decision and ran away and climbed the first tree he found. But you can see that this tree is not comfortable to stay. It was a matter of time he's falling down or not, because his tree was completely surrounded by the wild pigs. And this the mother heard the situation and here she comes. As the boy was crying, here she comes. She's a brave mother. I know all the mothers are brave. They will do anything to save their cubs. But in this case, she has a plan. plan is she's going to walk towards the wild pigs and we'll take the attention to herself. Meantime, the boy can run away and escape. That's the plan. It worked. Almost perfectly, it worked. I mean, almost, because though the boy could run away, the mother couldn't. She was completely surrounded by the wild pigs, and now they're biting her, they are stepping on her, they are using their heads to do the strong head kicks. So this is happening for a few seconds, not even 30 seconds, but it was a bad accident for herself. And she managed to run away finally with lots of injuries. She lost more than half of her tail from that accident. Not only that, she has a broken jaw. You can see one teeth, lower canine teeth is broken and hanging. So she was walking with this hanging teeth for the last 3.5 years. So she's a brave mother. She's a super mother. Even with these injuries, she managed to raise her boy up to the adulthood. And about 2 years ago, the boy separated from his mother. And now he has gone to a completely new area. And he is a very promising boy. He is big and he's a good fighter. That's the one. The one who came to the screen, that's the boy in our story. So he's a strong, big male. Now he has become a dominant leopard. Of course, he's a star leopard. But today, everything is possible because of the mother's brave action. So this is the boy and one of his girlfriends behind him. So he's a big boy. Right. So now I come to a few stories which are very weird, but very interesting. So first one, okay, I will go with some videos. Here we go. Right, so in that case, the two females, they were close relatives, so they were happy. They were happy to share the same male, okay? The reason was they knew they are relatives, and this is a win-win situation. I mean, either way, it works for their family lineage. That's what they need. They need to continue their family lineage. That's what they want to do. So there was no competition to win the male. That's why they were tolerating each other, right? So that's understandable, but there was a situation in Sri Lanka with a very similar situation, but different results. Okay, the South African cousins were happy to share the male, but the Sri Lankan girls were not happy. There was a reason for here. They were living in nearby areas, but they were not relatives. They were coming from two family lineages. So they were fighting to win the best genes from this male. So next day, there was only one female and the male spending their honeymoon. And the one who lost had to go away. Yeah. Now come to the last story. Okay, this is going to be more weird. Weirder. Here, I will play it. It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's our problem-free philosophy. Hakuna Matata.
Hakuna Matata?
Yeah, it's our motto.
What's the motto?
Nothing. What's the motto with you? You know what? These two words will solve all your problems.
That's right. Take Pumbaa for example.
This is a photo from the same sighting. So yeah, it is very interesting. But this female, she doesn't relate to any of these males. But the father and son, it's a confirmed relationship. Okay, the story behind this thing is very, let me tell you. So the campan male, that's the father who is the dominant male still. And he sired a lot of cubs in the area. And his last son was the two-toned male, right? After that, he had a problem. As he was getting old, he became infertile. though he's mating, because still he's the young, he's still the dominant male, so he has all the rights to mate with all the females, but no cubs anymore. And he understood it. But he wanted to continue his bloodline, his legacy in the area. So he came up with a weird plan. Instead of forcing his son, who was almost adult, he allowed his son to stay with him and even allowed him to mate with the same female. So it doesn't matter who is the true biological father, because it's the same blood, same gene. So it could work. So the father wanted to take the chance here. So that's why there was a sighting like that. And this was the first time for everyone, even for the scientists, even for the guides. This was the first time. But we could tell the story. We could narrate the story correctly because we knew the identity of the leopards. We knew the relationship of the leopards. And we were observing them for a long time. And we knew what's happening around them. And we could tell the story around their next move. So we knew their plan according to all the information we had. So that was a very interesting story for everyone. That's why I wanted to tell you that story as our last and final story. Okay, that's the end of the stories and end of the sessions. I hope you like it. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned new things. Still, I'm sure you could have some questions in your mind. Please don't be shy. Ask me all the questions. I'm more than happy to stay a few more minutes and to answer all the questions. Right. Sarah, any questions? Any comments?
Well, guys, yes, please. There's one question. How many leopards about in Wilpattu National Park?
Okay, Wilpattu National Park. That was a tricky one because it has been closed for so many years due to the conflicts inside the country. And it was reopened in 2010. And since then, there were few people who are doing research. But most of the leopards are still shy because when they were young, they were not exposed to the people. So now they are very shy. So photography evidence of leopards in Wilpattu is very rare. There are leopards. We take photos and footages in Wilpattu, but most of them are very shy. And there was research with the camera footages, camera traps recently. According to that, it should be close to at least 300 leopards in Wilpattu National Park, but majority of them are very shy. So, but the rough idea would be about 300, but not exactly. That's not the exact number. It's a rough number with the estimation, because that research was done in part of the national park and that result was applied to the whole park. That's how we came up with the number 300, but it could be more or less. It's in Wilpattu, but considering the country Sri Lanka, we believe it should be about just about 1,000 individuals in the country. Yeah, it doesn't sound much, right, Sarah? 1,000. But still, considering the size of the country and considering the remaining jungles of the country, it's a good number. 1,000, 1,200 would be the rough amount of leopards in Sri Lanka. Okay, anything?
Any questions, guys? Sorry, the connection, there was a small problem, so I just reconnected. So do we have any questions, any clarifications that you want to make? So this is the time. Please feel free, and Dhanu will be there to help you out. Let me see if we have any questions coming in.
It could be anything. It could be the leopards, okay. Identification, stories,
yeah,
anything.
That is one question. Sorry to interrupt. It says, considering the surroundings, would you say it's easier to spot animals in Yala than Wilpattu?
Okay. I would say it is easy to spot leopards and other animals in Yala. There's a reason. In Wilpattu, most of the time, we will go through a very dense forest. There are animals, but as soon as they go about 5 meters from our roads, they vanish. It's a gone animal. But in Yala, it's more open areas. So you can see the animals even for the distance. And Yala has been open for so many years continuously, and almost all the animals are very habituated with the vehicles. They're not scared. They're not running away from the vehicles. So due to that reason, the open areas and the habituation of the animals, it is easier to see animals in Yala. I mean, take a time slot, like 3 hours, 3 hours safari, you will see more animals in Yala. In Wilpattu, there will be the same diversity and could be the same density of the animals, but chances of seeing animals could be lower than the Yala. But both national parks are very good for the animals. I have to admit that. I am enjoying both national parks, same amount, for different reasons.
Yeah, and also there's one more question, Dhanu. It is to know if there's a particular time of the year which is good to spot leopards. And is it the early morning safari better than the afternoon?
Okay, that's a tricky question even for me. Okay, let me answer like this. Okay, a better time of the year. It depends. I mean, throughout the whole year, we see the leopards. Okay, dry season and rain season also. The rain season is the same time that we get the maximum number of tourists to the country. That is from November up to the April. That is the rainy season. Still, we see the leopards, right? The guests or the participants coming to the safaris, they see the leopards. But I have to admit, if you are a photographer, there is a better chance in the dry season. Okay, few reasons: less number of vehicles and less number of guests to the park. So you have a better chance to have kind of like have an exclusive sighting. So it's a much better. And then the water. There's less amount of water, and there will be only very few remaining water holes. And all the leopards, all the animals are concentrated around those water holes. And it is very easy to predict the movement of the animals, including the leopards. So if you are a photographer, I know you are very patient with the animals. You can wait a few hours for the animals. So then it will be there will be a higher, slightly higher chance to see leopards and to see better sightings in the dry season. That is normally from May up to the up to November. That is the dry season. And the time of the day, it is still I can't figure it out. It works both way. Sometimes morning safaris are very good. We see a lot of leopards, and the evening is dull. And next day it could be the opposite. The morning could be dull, no sighting, nothing, and the evening could be better. So we take our chances. It totally depends on the day. It depends on the luck. So I can't tell an answer for that.
All okay. Right. I guess that's all the questions we have for today. But Dhanu, in case we have any more questions or clarifications to be made, we will always direct it to you. And you can always write to us at any time. Any further information you want, you can write to us. Then we are happy to help you out. So I hope all of you enjoyed this session. It would have been very interactive, and I have no doubt all of you participated very enthusiastically. So thank you so much, Dhanu. Thanks for your time. And thank you all for participating for today's webinar. And today's webinar was brought to you together with Sensory Indulgence and Leopard Trails, together with Deetham Travel. So the recording of this session will be shared to you in the near future. And until we meet next month, I bid goodbye. And everyone, stay safe. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Dhanu. Thanks a lot. It was very interesting and very informative, and we learned a lot. Zara, even we didn't know much about leopards and got to know more about leopards from today's session.
Yeah, thank you for all the kind words.
Yeah, because...
Durga, you're breaking.
I noticed maybe if we can inform these tribes. But is, can you hear me now?
Yes, Durga, much better. Yeah.
But if we can give these kind of information to the guest when they're staying at the resort, like in the night while having the dinner, just some sort of information, and it'll be they will get in.
Exactly.
To know more about it rather than just going sleep, because it will make the casual wildlife into a hardcore wildlife. That will transform them, you know.
Exactly.
So I found it very interesting, and thank you so much.
Great. Pleasure. It was a great pleasure to be
thanks,
here.
Thank you, Durga.
We'll wrap it up, no?
Yes.
Cool. Thank you, guys. Thanks a lot for putting this together as well, and for having me and Dhanu over. It's fantastic. And like Durga said, what anyway Dhanu does is sometimes if he has a bit of time after the evening game drive and before dinner, he will speak to the guests, and if they're okay, he can even do this session right before dinner, which he has done for a few of the clients that were there in camp. Isn't it so, Dhanu?
Yeah, that exactly there. But I need to be very careful in that case. Sometimes the people, they don't like to go for a presentation, and they have doubts in their mind. So I select very specific people who are very enthusiastic about the leopards and they are keen to learn. Then I pick them and offer this. But anyone who stay with us in Leopard Trails, they can ask me, and I'm more than happy to share.